Good afternoon, Facebook Live. This is Robin Kirby Ghetto. Welcome to today. We're going to have an awesome day in the Lord. Amen. As you join on, what am I going to say? I know you already know it. Be expectant and hopeful. Amen. God is going to bring a word of encouragement. He's going to edify. He's going to encourage us, strengthen us, and we are just going to be like supercharged. Hallelujah. In Jesus' name. Also, I just want to bring up the reminder, we will be meeting in Birmingham, Alabama this Saturday at 6 p.m., not 5 p.m. It is college football season. Rich and I do not take vacations. Our vacation is actually watching a football game on television. When I say television, I just mean via streaming. And so we will do 6 p.m. in Birmingham, Alabama. Those of you who are interested this Saturday, I see Candace. I see Mary Holt. God bless y'all. Hey, Kathy Forbes. Hey, Debbie. Hey, Donna. God bless you. Hey, Kim Mitchell. Hey, Janelle. God bless you. Thank you for joining in. Hey, Rosie Wells. So good to see you on here. We're going to have an awesome day in the Lord. Amen. Thank you, Donna. You are beautiful as well, sister. So as you join on, saints of God, be hopeful and expectant. And also, for those of you who are in business, if you need encouragement, get onto my page, A Limitless Life. It is really going to encourage you over there as well. Thank you, Kathy. God bless you. Aloha. I like that. Hey, Missy Smith. So good to see you, sister. Thank you for joining in. We're going to have an awesome time today. And as we get ready, oh my goodness, I cannot wait to see what Holy Spirit is going to bring. I'm actually going to take a sip of coffee because I've been running around this morning and I just got home and I'm getting refreshed a little bit right before we begin. Amen. Thank you, Lord. God, we thank you for the power of Holy Spirit. We thank you, God, that you are faithful, that you, Father God, have plans for us to give us a hope and a future. And that today, God, those who are joining in, that God, you strengthen them in Jesus' name. I come against every assignment of discouragement, every lying serpent that's on your neck, and I command it to be lifted off in Jesus' name. I command weariness, heaviness, be lifted off in Jesus' name. And I speak hope in Christ Jesus be upon you. And that God strengthen you in that hope. And that you are expectant. And by the spirit of understanding, hallelujah, you're being prepared to enter into the word. In Jesus' name, amen. Hey, Gina, so good to see you on here. I saw you earlier. Thank you for joining in, Gina Reeves. So awesome. Hey, Deborah Faulkner. Hey, Michelle. God bless you. Hey, Cheryl. God bless you guys. Hey, Tina. Love you, sister. And I see a few more people joining on. Hey, Evelyn. Long time, sister. So good to have you on here. And Kathy Young. God bless you. Thank you for joining in. Well, are you ready? Because one of the things that God has been dealing with is what? Thoughts and emotions. And when we look at thoughts and emotions, we're looking at, if you have not looked at the series, go to my YouTube channel about thoughts and emotions, especially over the last 3 weeks, I've been doing this series. And so when we're looking at thoughts and emotions, we're looking at, first and foremost, strongholds where God is causing us to rise up. Hey, David, thank you for joining in. And hey, Janelle, thank you for joining in. We're looking at God causing us to have strength, right? To take every thought captive. We're going to now start to get on the other side of that as well as we speak about godly emotions and being stirred up with godly emotions. And one of our scriptures, and oh my goodness, I got my Bible back. Here it is. I got my Bible back. You can't really see the color good, but this is a green turquoise. It is absolutely beautiful. I love it. Let me give a shout out to Norris Binding in Greenwood, Mississippi. Get them. And they actually put, and I know Carrie Crane wanted to see the inside. There's the inside. And I got them to put some extra pages in there because I do a gazillion notes and all that. So I actually got them to put some extra pages in there, both in the front and in the back. Carrie Crane wanted to see the inside. The binding is absolutely amazing. This is very expensive leather. It is totally worth it. It was over a couple hundred dollars, and I absolutely cannot be more satisfied. And I've got two ribbons. Look at that. I've got two ribbons. So that way I don't just have one ribbon to keep my place in the Word, but I get two ribbons to keep my place in the Word. And so as we look at today, we are going to have a super awesome day. Now that I've got my Amplified Classic Bible back, I feel like I'm ready to start off. Hey, Mega, God bless you. Thank you for joining in. And so let's look specifically as we look at Scripture, and we're going to look at 1 Corinthians 2, and this is where God is going to bring understanding. And let me just preface this. If you have not seen my post today, I encourage you to look at my posts. God generally, 99% of the time, has me do two posts in the morning along with one scripture to emphasize and just to give his people to chew on. And those posts totally come straight from his heart. Every morning that I post on Facebook, I'm not coming up with anything. I am strictly just listening to what the Father wants me to post. And if you haven't seen today's post, one of them especially speaks to the area of not comparing yourself to old seasons. You hear all the time not to compare yourself to other people, but God was really emphasizing this morning not to compare yourself to old seasons, because that's an attack of the enemy, because the enemy will make you look at your zeal in this season, and he'll bring it to your mind and make you feel like you're failing because you're in a different place right now. But God is really emphasizing in this hour the need for us to overcome emotional strongholds, emotional addictions. And so you might not find yourself so emotional sometimes. And that is not necessarily a bad thing, because it's just where God is taking like a big pair of scissors, is the best analogy I can give you. And he's just cutting those old emotions, those ungodly emotions off of you from your past, and he's giving you new emotions. Now, emotions are great, and we're about to look at emotions, and we're going to get better understanding of how we are developed, created from the Father, and how he has made us emotional. We're also going to look at Genesis 15, and God is going to give you both sides of those emotions. He's going to show you before and after of Abram, Father Abraham, and he's going to give you a depiction and show you a before and after of Father Abraham as he lets go of old emotions and as he moves forward into the new. Amen. So we're going to look specifically today and begin in 1 Corinthians 2. 1 Corinthians 2, amen. Hey, Jean, so good to see you on here. Hey, Anna, so good to see you on here. 1 Corinthians 2, and we're going to look at verse 5. Scripture says, "So that your faith might not rest in the wisdom of men, human philosophy, but in the power of God." Now listen to that again, and listen to the emphasis of this scripture, and then we're going to go to the next scripture, and we're going to get emphasis from that, and it's going to be about our emotions. So in verse 5 of 1 Corinthians 2, Scripture says, "So that your faith might not rest in the wisdom of men, human philosophy, but in what? The power of God." And this is where God is bringing us balance, because we don't realize that our human emotions in some area of our life, just because we're human, right? We are working out our salvation in fear and trembling. We are being justified, hallelujah, purified, sanctified by the power of the blood of Christ Jesus. We are in Jesus' name. And we're continue working out our salvation in what? Fear and trembling. Nobody is perfect. There's only one perfect man. Amen, Anna. There's only one perfect man, and that is Jesus Christ. We are being perfected. And we're going to look at this emotionally today, because you're going to see And I'm tying this a lot on my wall that is business oriented. It is a limitless life. God really has me tying this in, because you're going to find out, as God talks about in Joshua 1:8, for Joshua to meditate on the word day and night, and as he meditates on the word, he will prosper and what? Have good success. We see this expressed as well in 3 John 1:2. Beloved, I wish that you would prosper above all things in life and in health as your what? Soul prospers. God's Firewall Healing, the Soul series, it's on Amazon that God's had me write. That series is based on 3 John 1:2. And let's look at this from a contractual avenue, because it's going to provide greater understanding. Faith comes by understanding, hearing, understanding what? The Word. And so God brings all these different angles, revelation, parables, the Word, truth, combining scriptures, combining truth, giving analogies, and interpreting them. Holy Spirit combines scriptures. That's what 1 Corinthians 2 says. Holy Spirit combines the scriptures, and Holy Spirit interprets them to you and I, so that this message, God is combining these specific scriptures together, and Holy Spirit is going to interpret all these scriptures, and Holy Spirit is going to bring revelation. Holy Spirit is going to bring understanding. Amen. Because it is necessary for us to get on the other side. It is necessary for us to enter God's promises. It is necessary, hallelujah, for us to take down the giants in Jesus' name. And so Holy Spirit is going to strengthen you in order that you overcome. When we look at Matthew 4, after Jesus is baptized in Matthew 3 in the Jordan, and he comes forth up, Holy Spirit descends like a dove, comes upon Jesus Christ, the heavens are open, the Father's voice is heard audibly. This is my what? Beloved Son, in whom I'm well pleased. So as we look at this avenue today of different angles and understanding the positive emotions, holy emotions that the Father has given us, we have to see it through this lens. What is that? Jesus was endued with power, and Holy Spirit led Jesus into the wilderness, Matthew 4. And we see there that two of the areas in which the Satan tempted Jesus and Jesus overcame, he did not give in to temptation, amen. Jesus overcame every temptation. And the wilderness represents the voice of the enemy, or can we say the emotional attachment that you are susceptible to that could tempt you, that God is exposing it. That's 1 Peter 1:6 and 7. Be exceedingly glad. Rejoice when you experience fiery trials and tribulations and suffer temptations, that the testing of your faith, which is more precious than gold, will redound to your praise, to your glory, to your honor. What? When Christ Jesus is revealed. And so the wilderness is first and foremost us what? Humbling ourselves. We humble ourselves sometimes in fasting. That is the best way to humble yourself. And you listen to what you have the grace to do. For those that have been doing the judgment fast, we've been doing 2 meals a week. That's all it is, 2 meals a week. And you pick the 2 days. You pick those the meals that you want to do on those 2 days. And then in September, that was Luke 6. We've been doing Luke 6, 42 fast. Take the beam out of our own eye. But now in September, we're going to do Luke 6, 35. Love your enemy. Oh my goodness. How awesome is it going to be for us to do that fast? I just think about how much this fast on judgment and the emotional addiction that we have in judging everything, every circumstance, every person, and how God's been delivering us and set us free. How much more freedom are we going to get in September when we fast and do Luke 6, 35, love your enemy? Because we're going to find out that love of Christ in us that we're rooted deeply, grounded securely in, Ephesians 3, 16 through 20, that love of Christ is an emotion. It's a current. It's a power. It's a frequency. And it brings the grace, the anointing, the message of hope, the message of eternal salvation. And I get into frequencies. If you see me posting about it a lot, I get into that in my book, Rev 22.2. This is my latest book on Amazon. It's for Watchmen. And I get into Tesla, which I've written this, Rev 22.2, 5 years ago. But God had me expound on it and bring a deeper understanding, knowledge, and wisdom to it that is absolutely mind-blowing. And one of the things that he brings us into greater understanding about is about frequencies and oscillations. And I get into that book. I brought it frequently, just a little bit on here, a snippet. And I want to bring the snippet again because we see the metaphor of water used for frequency in the Bible, used for current power. Because when you think of frequency, everything that is alive has frequency. Our hearts, our brains. That's the way they determine if you're still alive. They hook you up to an EKG, and it's funny because that's what I'm studying in this class that I'm doing in health and fitness training. And they hook your brain up to see that your brain waves are alive, right? And so that EEG is letting you know that your brain waves are alive. And that's how they know that the person is alive, because of frequencies, because of oscillations, which are like, what, waves, okay? Everything in the universe, everything that's alive has frequency, it has waves. And so also, when we look at this today, we're going to see this as an analogy. Now, some of y'all might feel like this is over your head. Holy Spirit is telling me to tell you, be at peace. God's going to bring understanding later. Just hang on and wait for the message. It's going to be so powerful. You're going to absolutely love it. And so when we look at Romans 1:20, Scripture tells us that the God of the invisible, we can't see God with our natural eyes, right? But it says he shows himself in the visible display of creation, of what he's created. And so God wants to be seen. God wants to be seen through creation, right? And he gives us the thumbprint of his nature through the expression of his creation. Hey, Sherry Stenham, I love you. And so when we look at today, we are going to look at the expression of God's love that is revealed in the metaphor of frequency. So let's look at and think about Revelation 1:15. Scripture says, Jesus has the voice of many waters. It also says about God's people in John 6. I think it's verse 38. I'm not just sure on the actual verse itself. But out of our belly will flow what? Rivers of living waters. Out of our belly will flow rivers of living waters. Hold on 1 second. I always just like to make sure I have the scripture and verse. And as we see this, that water, again, is a metaphor. Also, Isaiah 59:10 says, when the enemy comes in like what? A flood. That's water. What? It's John 7:38. God raises a standard and sends the enemy what? Fleeing and what? Seven direction. So we see water with the voice of Jesus Christ. We see water where out of our belly will come rivers of living water. And with the enemy, he comes in like water. He comes in like a flood. And so water represents a metaphor. It's a metaphor that represents current. Because in Greek, when we look at the river in Revelation 22, that river of life, that river in heaven, right? That word river in Greek means current. When we look at current with water as a metaphor, out of our belly, John 7:38, will come rivers of living water. The enemy comes in like a flood. Jesus has the voice of many waters. Again, that is a metaphor for current, for power. When we look at electricity, electricity represents what? Power. We have lights on. Because we have electricity in the walls that's running as a current, that's actually what is called. That current of electricity has an alternating current, which I teach on in the book, and it oscillates like a wave. Why? Because if it just went straight, it would fade away and it would lose its potency. Instead, with alternating current, it creates a wave, an oscillation, just like everything in the universe has an oscillation. Tesla, the father of electricity, designed alternating current, and so we were able to sustain a greater level of plugging in electrical items, providing power into the homes, because that alternating current was made available, and it builds power up and it doesn't fade away. So when we look at this sense of God, God is going to bring us understanding. There's two different frequencies. There's the frequency Jesus, the voice of many waters, his power, his message, and then Isaiah 59:10, the enemy comes in like a flood. There's the frequency, the current, the message, he is the prince of the air, of the enemy that comes in that frequency. And so whether you know it or not, you are susceptible to the frequencies that are in your atmosphere, that are around you. And I actually get into the book in greater measure of how praying in your spiritual language, how it literally breaks up the frequency of the enemy, and how it brings the power of God, and it just opens up the atmosphere, and you're able to hear God's still small voice, and it amplifies the word, and your mind is focused, you're not confused, and you're able to hear God on a greater grace. And this is what we're going to look at with your emotions. You've got to understand that this message is tailor-made for you. That's how much God cares about you. He has got this message tailor-made for you, that he wants you set free of these emotional strongholds, and he wants you walking in holy emotions, or can I say, breakthrough, deliverance, triumph. Now understand, when you get this and you cross over, let's say the Jordan, you cross over into your promises, guess what this is going to do for your whole family? See, it's going to affect your whole family. And if you can analogize this, think of this, and this is a great analogy. Imagine that on your waist, you've got different ropes tied to each family member, and those ropes represent your prayers. And what you're praying, what you're agreeing, what you're thinking about, what God is telling you to declare, right? And so imagine that you're pulling all of your family members. You feel like you're pulling them with your prayers. Why does this happen? You feel weary and you feel burdened. It's not the Lord's burden, because his burden is easy and light, right? But the reason that you feel that way is because first and foremost, you need freedom. And so imagine when you get freedom and you have the yoke of Christ Jesus on you, and now you have those ropes to your family members. You're not pulling them in your strength, hallelujah. It is not by your power. It is not by your might, hallelujah. It is by the Spirit of God in you, hallelujah, that you start declaring, decreeing, praying, prophesying, and all of a sudden there is a momentum. There's a change in the atmosphere. There is what many hate to hear, and sometimes I hate to hear it, but this is the only word that God's bringing to me. A shift. You shift out of the old mindset, and all of a sudden the switch flips, and you get into a new mindset. The renewing of the mind, Romans 12:1-2. And this is what we're looking at today, where Abram shifts from an old mindset, and he gets into a new mindset. Because fear has gripped his soul, and he's just now experiencing the fear in Genesis 15, which we're not going to get to immediately, but we're fixing to. I'm leading you up with this preface. And in Genesis 15, we see the fear that grips Abram. The curtains are pulled back. We see the fear, and it's right in his face. He can't deny it anymore. And this is what God is doing with all of us. God's pulling back the curtains. And God is saying, let me show you what emotion you're addicted to. Because why? We need this confronted, as God showed us in the last teaching that I did. If you imagine that instead of running away from your emotions, right? Instead of fleeing from them, that you pull a chair up and you look at that emotion right in the face and you look at it for what it is in order to be aware of your need, that you need the power of Holy Spirit. You need the Father, because remember, Holy Spirit comes according to the need. Give us this day our daily bread. God, what do I need Holy Spirit for today? Not just the things that I have to do in my life, activities, right? But also, what do I need renewing in my mind for today? Because it all starts right here. As you think in your heart, what? So are you. And so many of you are doing the call that God has in your life. Whether you're working for somebody, whether you have your own business, whether you're a student, whether you're a mom, whether you are pursuing your dream of entrepreneurship, whatever it is you're doing, you have a desire, a dream, a hope that God's given you, right? And you also have things going on with your family where different areas of your family need breakthrough, need freedom, need healing, need deliverance. And this is what God is showing me. As you get your breakthrough, like Joshua 1, he emphasizes to Joshua, I taught this probably about 8 or 9 years ago. God emphasized to Joshua, only you be strong and courageous, and I will cause Israel to inherit the promise. Do you understand that God used one man to cause millions, to cause a whole nation to enter into the promise? And so this is what God is telling us. God is saying, listen, you just believe. You hang on. You make the transition. You cross over the Jordan, hallelujah. Be dealt with at Gilgal. And you get ready, hallelujah, to cross into the promises of God, which are yes and amen. These are holy emotions. Our emotions are being purified. Are you super excited? I am. So let's look specifically now at 1 Corinthians 2, verse 4, and then we're going to go to Genesis. Amen, Jenny. Then we're going to go to Genesis 15, and you're literally going to see this transition take place with Father Abraham, and you're going to see his freedom. You're going to see his deliverance. And this is why you cannot compare this season that you're in to your old season. Because the enemy is going to get you distracted on that. I know this. I know. And the enemy is going to get you into emotions. And he's going to have you look at your emotional zeal. I know what I'm talking about. In your old seasons with God. And he's going to start whispering in your ear, hey, in your old season, you had this. Like, I'll just give you an example, okay? Robin, 4 years ago, you were saying all these things in caps. Well, guess what? I was very highly emotional then. And I was pumped up then. But remember, God is purifying our emotions. It's great to be excited. I love to be excited. I'm excited most of the time. But there's also some humility that God is bringing in with that. And so in this season, as you get ready to cross over into the God's promises in a greater measure, you're going to find yourself with your emotions. They're just going to be totally different. They're going to be totally different from years ago. And that is not bad. That is humility. And God is purifying your emotions. He's sanctifying your emotions so that you will walk with a temperance. And that temperance is part of your personal reality. That temperance forms your personality. So you might see some videos that I did 5 years ago. Even though it's me 5 years ago, I will tell you that my personality is different even today from 5 years ago. And this is not a bad thing. This is a good thing because I am maturing in love, the love of Christ Jesus, 2 Corinthians 3:18. From glory to glory with what? An unveiled face. As we behold the glory of God with an unveiled face, we are being transformed into that likeness from glory to glory. We see this with the disciples. When the disciples have all this zeal, when God called me out to ministry, I had all this zeal, and I was like, God, I want to do that. And of course, He had years in training me before I went into full-time ministry. And when He took me into full-time ministry, I was like, God, I don't even want to do ministry. I have no desire to do it. Just like Moses in the back of the desert when God called him back to Egypt. And Moses was like, send Aaron, my brother. I stutter. I don't want to do it. And you find excuses of why not to do the call of Christ Jesus or not to do the greatness that God has called you into. And that is because you've been humbled. You've been so broken that you don't have a desire to do it because that is how broken you are. And when you get that broken, And when you get that broken, that is when God will use you because your emotions are being purified. They're being sanctified so that when you go out and you do what God's called you to do, that you're not doing it emotionally out of just your emotions, but your spirit led and your temperaments has been made mature in the love of Christ. And so that's why God doesn't want you to compare yourself to 5 years ago, 6 years ago. He doesn't want you to compare yourself to others. He wants you to enjoy this season and get into the place of holy emotions. Amen. So let's look at 1 Corinthians 2 and let's look specifically at verse 4. Paul says, now this is when Paul is breaking. In fact, I just love 1 Corinthians 2 again. Y'all have heard me a gazillion times. Is one of my go-to chapters. It's almost in every book. It's almost in every preaching that I do where I give a summation. But let's start in verse 1 to build up to verse 4 because this really shows you the brokenness, the humility of the Apostle Paul. And God is just pulling back the curtain on this apostle's life. And you're seeing the DNA of his relationship with God. Is that not potent? Is that not powerful? Because think about Paul before. He was Paul. He was what? Saul. And he wanted to do what? Kill Christians. And he was very emotional. Okay? So his emotions were ungodly. And then he met Jesus Christ. And Jesus asked him why he was persecuting him. Because he was not just persecuting Christians. He was persecuting Jesus Christ. And that's the road to Damascus. And then all of a sudden, Saul becomes so broken that he changes his name to Paul Little. In fact, my battery's getting low, so I have to speed up. And so this is what you're seeing, so let me speed up. 1 Corinthians 2, verse 1. As for myself, brethren, when I came to you, I did not come to you proclaiming to you the testimony and evidence or mystery and secret of God concerning what he has done through Christ for the salvation of men in lofty words of eloquence, our human philosophy and wisdom. For I resolved to know nothing, to be acquainted with nothing, to make a display of the knowledge of nothing, and to be conscious of nothing among you except Jesus Christ and Him crucified. And I was passed into a state of weakness and fear, humility, dread, great trembling after I'd come among you. And my language, this is the emphasis, and my message were not set forth in persuasive, enticing, plausible words of wisdom, but they were in demonstration of the Holy Spirit and power, a proof by the Spirit and the power of God operating on me and stirring in me and stirring in the minds of the hearers the most holy emotions, and thus persuading them. And so when we're humbled, when we are broken, think about this. The message of God in you is so powerful that when people hear that message, you stir up, woo, sanctified emotions in them, hallelujah. You have a grace on you by wisdom, by power, hallelujah, to stir up holy, pure emotions, or can I say, by Holy Spirit and the grace of God on you, you are able to attach that person by grace to the Word, hallelujah, with great emotions. So now they're having a renewed, transformed mind, hallelujah. They know the voice of many waters. They feel the current, the power of that message coming out of your belly, hallelujah, that's Spirit-led, and they are brought into a refreshing, into newness, into hope, hallelujah. And so this is what we're going to see with Father Abraham, and this is where we're going to go quickly because my battery's about to go out. I forgot to charge it. So let's go to Genesis 15. Genesis 15, verse 1. And I apologize for doing this very fast at the very end, but I do not want the battery to run out. Scripture says, after these things, the word of the Lord came to Abram in a vision, saying, fear not, fear, ungodly emotion. Abram, I am your shield, your abundant compensation, your reward, and your exceedingly shall be exceedingly great. And Abram said, Lord God, what can you give me since I'm going on from this world childless? And he shall be owner and heir over my house is the steward Eleazar of Damascus. And Abram continued, look, you have given me no child, and a servant born in my house is an heir. And behold, the word of the Lord came to him, saying, this man shall not be your heir, but he who shall come from your own body shall be your heir. And he brought him outside his tent into the starlight. And he said, look now towards the heavens and count the stars, if you are able to number them. Then he said to him, so shall your descendants be. And he, Abram, believed in, trusted on, remained steadfast to the Lord. And God counted it to him, Abraham, as righteousness, right standing with God. So let's close here as God brings us emphasis. And what's interesting is verse 7 says, we cannot forget this, and he said to him, I am the same Lord who brought you out of Ur of the Chaldeans to give you this land as your inheritance. And so this is what God showed me. God said, Robin, you saw Abraham's fear before, ungodly emotion, right? Addiction. Why? Because of circumstance, circumstance, circumstance. Remember in all my other past videos, emotions come from either relationships or circumstances in your past that you're tied to. You're experiencing those same emotions, those circumstances, those relationships over and over. And so Abram is consumed in his person. I'm not going to have a child. I'm not going to have a child. I'm not going to have a child. Circumstances. And so the curtain's pulled back. Fear comes up. And God shows him, this is what we're going to address, because this is what's holding you back. And he said, fear not, for I am your shield, your exceeding great reward. In other words, he's renewing Abram's mind. And he's giving him a mind of prosperity, of success, of breakthrough, of triumph, of good success. And this is what God is doing for you and me. He is bringing us to the place, and he's pulling back the curtains, and he's saying, fear, judgment, insecurity, rejection, ungodly jealousy. And he's showing us all of these things that we have in our past circumstance still been emotionally tied to, and us praying for our family, us interceding, prophesying, declaring is almost not having as much effect because we ourselves are emotionally in bondage and our unbelief is wrestling against the Word of God. And here God is waking us up and delivering us from those emotions as we, hallelujah, see the heavens and see the stars and know that God's promises for us are yes and amen. The stars are still speaking. Although they have no voice, their light speaks. It's called frequency. That's how we hear stars. Stars' light has a frequency, and it can be heard. And that light is speaking to us today that Jesus is the bridegroom. He is the bright and morning star. And the power of that light, hallelujah, John 1:5, pierces the darkness. And the darkness cannot overcome it. It cannot put it out. It is unreceptive to it. And so when we look at this transition with Abram, all of a sudden the fear is exposed and deposed, hallelujah, as God brings him into promise. And God says, this will be what I'm giving you. And this word here, where it says, it was accounted unto Abram as righteous. Oh my goodness, get ready. It's a Hebrew word, chashab. Why is that so important? Chashab is actually in my new book, Rev 22, 2, where I talk about Jeremiah 29, 11, 13, where God says, for I know the thoughts, machashaba, that I have for you, says the Lord, that I have towards you. Machashaba, thoughts, that comes from the Hebrew word chashab. And it means, which is what I went over 2 weeks ago, to plat, to invent, think, thought. It indicates all of this. So when we look at, it was accounted to Abram as righteousness. That's when God made Abram the invention of his promise. And this is what God has been showing me lately that I've been doing in my coaching, because I've been doing health and wellness coaching with different clients. And this is the thing that God's been having me share with a lot of clients that I've been coaching. Because as I talk about us being an invention in my book, Rev 22:2, God showed me a lever. When you need an invention to work, you turn the lever, and that's the on switch pretty much, and that causes the invention to work. And God gave me a vision for his people, and he said, Robin, with that invention is who God's called you to be, by the word of God in you. His word is creative. His word is powerful. It's alive, right? And God showed me that many people don't have the lever to the invention, to themselves. And I'm going to have to hurry up because it's saying low battery. And this is what God showed me. He said, it's all emotional. When you get set free of past emotions, you're going to walk into holy emotions. And that lever to turn on that invention is going to be there. And you're going to have a confidence and know his thoughts, hallelujah, towards you. And you are going to have that accounting unto righteousness. Or can I say, it's going to happen, hallelujah. And this is what's interesting. Because Abram was from Ur of the Chaldeans. Ur means flame, to consume. And then when we look at Chaldeans, it actually comes from a word that means peasant. And this is what God showed me. He had to bring Abram out of being consumed from the spirit of poverty, from a lack mentality. God brought him out of that, hallelujah, and he transformed and renewed his mind, and he brought him into promises that were beyond his imagination. That's what God's dealing with you right now. He is cutting off these ungodly emotions from past circumstances. He's setting us free, hallelujah. And he is moving us into holy emotions, like Paul talks about in 1 Corinthians 2, that we have a message. It is resolute. We are steadfast. We are standing our ground. We are going to see the fulfillment of God's promises. Yes and amen. And we are consumed with that invention. Or can I say, we are consumed with seeing those promises invented in those lives. Is that not powerful? And so as you get set from ungodly emotions and your emotions are purified, sanctified, and made holy, you prophesy and you declare and you watch the power, the current, woo, the voltage, the power that's going to come out of your mouth, and it is not only going to set you free, but it is going to set others free. In Jesus' name, amen. I love you. God bless you. I will see you next week.